Hi, welcome to Live from the Lockdown Lounge. Welcome to Tuesday night in Melbourne. And boy, have we got a show for you. Royalty, music royalty we have on tonight. My name is Brian. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for taking me into your lounge room, your bedroom, your toilet, whatever room you take me into. I am there with you on your little iPad or phone, just looking up at you and going, thanks for bringing me around your house. What are we about? If you don't know yet, where have you been? Okay, Live from the Lockdown Lounge, it's all about supporting the music industry, supporting the entertainment industry by telling stories. And that's what we do. We tell stories and we play a little bit of music. We sing, we laugh, and we chat. And we start by telling you that we are brought to you by the very important people, the wonderful people at Cranbourne Music. Thank you, Cranbourne Music, for bringing us to the entertainment industry. And you know what? Cranbourne Music stores are open. Their two stores are open. You need to be aware of that. They are ready to do business. All you have to do is go to the Lynbrook or Elizabeth Street City stores. Go in, say good day. You can shop online, you can click and collect, or you can get it delivered. Cranbourne Music, we love you. Well, for those of you that are perhaps watching for the first time, or perhaps watching for, you know, many, many times and just like to hear me ramble on, I will ramble on. You know, we've got all your favorite segments. We've got chat, we've got music, we've got gig chicken, we've got coping with lockdown, we've got a new segment, back when I thought I was cool. And of course, we always start off the night with pets are good for ratings. And of course, pets have nothing to do with music. We know that, but people like pets and more people watch us because we play videos of pets. And so we try and create some tenuous link between music and pets. And here we found it. In fact, we've got a toddler. That's good for ratings as well. New segment, toddlers are good for ratings. Toddlers and pets. So the toddler's playing music and then the dog comes in with a little bit of piano, a little bit of Elton John style. Roll the video. There you go. Didn't I tell you? How entertaining is this show? Where would you go on Tuesday night? And it's free. Unless, of course, you would like to donate, and you can donate to me anytime. Ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned, we have musical royalty with us tonight. I know this gentleman very, very well, and I'm very honoured to say that he's a good friend of mine and has been for many, many years. And so I guess if you're in the cover band world, you know, the mecca of cover bandom is Vegas. So if you're able, through a tribute band or a cover band or as a musician, to get to go to Vegas, you're doing pretty well. If you get to go to Vegas for 9 years, coming on 10 years straight, then you're friggin' awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest tonight is originally from New Zealand. He arrived in Australia in the late 80s. And immediately made his mark on the Melbourne music scene as one of the most in-the-pocket bass players in the city. I'm talking in the firmly deep down in the pocket. That's how much in the pocket. He was an integral member of iconic Melbourne cover bands, including back when it wasn't actually cool to be a Prince tribute band. He was in one of the very first Melbourne Prince tribute bands and made it cool. He was in... And the a band called Killer Queen, who was a tribute to Queen, of course, back in the 90s. He was in an iconic cover band called Bratz. We'll talk a little bit about that later too. He simultaneously worked as a clerk at Minter Ellison legal firm. So he juggled his musical career while he was doing this in a legal firm. He's worked as a session musician, performing with such artists as Vanessa Amorosi, Shania Twain, Ronan Keating on various TV shows. So we're talking, you know, top of his game. Now, he is a founding member of the Australian Bee Gees show, which has been operating for, I reckon, about 25 years. He'll be able to confirm that. Traveling around the world to countries including China, the USA, Europe, the Middle East. He and the Australian Bee Gees show have enjoyed a 9-year residency in Vegas at the Excalibur Casino. 9 years, coming on to 10. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you music royalty, the amazing Tony Richards. Hello, Tony.
Hello, Brian. Thank you very much for that very generous introduction.
It was generous and true. They're the two things that come together to make it amazing, which is what you are. How do we find you, Tony? You well?
I'm well. I'm here in Melbourne, having arrived back home sort of early March.
Wow. Well, you've just spoiled the whole show because we've been advertising you as our first international guest, and within the first 3 seconds, you said you're in Melbourne. No, we did know that. You're in Melbourne because basically Vegas has been shut down.
Correct. We know the story there, right? So this was a planned holiday.
Oh, really? Okay.
But I wasn't planning for the elongation, if you will.
Yeah. No. Makes total sense. I mean, you have to come back every maybe a year or so to renew your visa. Is that right?
Because look, I like to try and get back, you know, at least once a year. Two would be nice, you know, to see family and friends, of course.
Yep.
Fortunately,
I'm one of those. I fall in one of those categories.
Absolutely, you do. you're normally on my hit list for a visit, you know, but. We can't travel out of our little suburbs right now, so we're living in an historic time, let's say.
Yeah. No, look, it's later on in the show, we're going to go into specifics about the whole Vegas experience.
Sure.
Not only about what you're doing now, but your journey to get there, because, like I said, really from musos. That's kind of the mecca of cover bandom, isn't it? I mean, to be in a band, a tribute band, to go to Vegas, that's kind of the mecca.
Sure. But look, to get back to your initial question, I'm well. I'm good. Happy to be here.
I know. I do tend to jump around a little bit, you know.
I steered you down that path. I led you there. So I'm going to throw back to you, Brian.
Well, thank you. I'm happy for a throw. So, look, let's talk about early years in Melbourne, because you came here in late 80s from New Zealand, and you were playing, you know, doing the cover band stuff and maybe a couple of original projects to start with, weren't you?
Well, first of all, New Zealand was a good place to grow up and to learn your instrument and to be exposed to great players. It was a guy called Chuck Morgan, who I initially had some lessons with, jazz guitar player. So these guys were quite influential, I guess, on my career on bass, you know. So, but yeah, look, it was New Zealand. It's a small country. I had to sort of leave shores and come here just for more opportunities, I guess.
Yeah, because there's so many good musos that come from New Zealand, but I guess the market isn't big enough, is it, to just in terms of the live music scene, or maybe perhaps back in the 80s there wasn't enough jobs going around.
Well, I think we've seen the number of live music venues dry up. Both. I mean, we've seen it here. It certainly happened in New Zealand. So, I guess you lose those places where you could once play.
Yep. And when you came over here, when we met, you were playing in a Prince tribute band. Refresh my memory what the name of that band was.
Well, I think we spent more time rehearsing than we actually did gigging.
Yes. Right?
That could have been Purple Rain.
Was it?
Was it?
I don't know. Called? I wasn't in the band, but I met you through a mutual friend, and you had Fallon, I believe, who was the singer, and he was from a great cover band in the 80s called Get Off the Cat.
Yeah, that's right.
I always thought they should have, because Fallon was in it, I thought they should have been called Fallon the Cat, but that's just me.
Maybe we would have got more gigs, but I remember doing eight gigs. But certainly more time was spent in the rehearsal studio.
Yeah. But I guess part of your journey in terms of exposing you to musos and things like that, you just kept building networks through that period, didn't you?
Well, it was. And, working with guys like Fallon, certainly. And I think when you do hit town, you want to get out there and network and just increase your odds of getting a gig, if you like, you know?
Yeah. Well, look, it helps to be an awesome player, which you are. Makes the odds a little bit better. You also played in a Queen tribute band, which did a lot of touring, a lot of sort of road trips and things like that. That was pretty successful. So we're talking 90s. Back before it was, you know, I guess... as common as what it is today, you were doing it back then.
Sure, and that was with Pete Goldsworthy on vocals.
Right.
My good friend Simon Croft on guitar, who has gone on, I might add, to perform We Will Rock You around the world.
Well, there you go. There you go. So that was probably the launch pad for him. So other bands around that time with band members that have gone on to bigger and better things, of course, is that great band Bratz. Now,
of course.
Now, you and I were in that band together, and we might have a still shot of us playing together. Now, in that band, so Bratz was the first letter of each band member's name, and so the original band members were myself, Brian, Rick Varley, who is well-known in the Melbourne music scene, great guitarist and vocalist, Andrew Patterson, who's well-known in the music theatre scene as a great orchestrator, a keyboard player.
And he was also with me on Killer Queen.
He was, that's right. Yeah. Then the T, of course, the one and only Tony Richards. And the S was Sean McLeod, who many people know from Taxi Ride. In fact, I haven't seen Sean McLeod in 20-odd years, or whatever it was. But, hey, Sean, if you're watching, it's me and Tony, the members of Bratz, two-thirds of Bratz is right here. Hit us up. Hey, but that was, like I said, so that was sort of the early 90s, mid-90s, but then you started to sort of, work as a session muso and start to work with some international acts as well, didn't you?
Certainly. And I was doing some sessions and things at Platinum.
Wow.
Sing Sing studios, working for various artists.
Yep. Yeah. No, look, you were very busy, and I back to my earlier point, in demand, because the fact is that you were you're a good player, you're a great player, and you were there to be got. And so we've got, in fact,
thank you.
In fact, our first, and we should explain that because you weren't planning on doing it, this wasn't a musical sort of holiday. You don't actually have a bass that's working with you, do you?
Well, I do have this, but it's a fretless bass.
Right.
The intonation is really, really bad. It's 40 years old. I found it at my mum's house recently. So, yeah, it's It's not going to work, Brian.
It's not going to work. No. And that's cool. And so, but hey, we at Live from the Lockdown Lounge, we've got ways to make things work. And so we've found some video of you back in the day in that time that we're talking about. First one is you playing with Shania Twain on Rove. And then the next one is you playing with Vanessa Amorosi on Yes. Hey Hey, It's Saturday. So we might play those that little mashup of both those performances. And then when we come back, we'll chat about that. So, ladies and gentlemen, Tony Richards already making a mark back in the 90s. A bit of Rove, a bit of Hey Hey. You know you've made it when you're on stage with Daryl Summers. Roll the video.
Just change your mind and we'll be fine. Work it out with me.
Oh, wow, Tony, how good was that? Is that, that's a bit of a trip down memory lane. Look how young and innocent and vibrant you look, as you do now, let me say. You do still now. But so first one was Shania. Tell us about that experience on Rove. What was that like?
Terrific. I mean, Sheba's out here promoting a single called Up.
Right.
And what better place to do that than Rove Life?
Yeah.
back in the Channel 10 studios in Nunawading at the time.
Yeah, wow.
I'm not even sure if they're still there, but it was a good experience. You know, it's her vocal was live, but that the band was to track.
Right, yeah. And do you remember, did you get to meet her or chat to her or anything like that?
Yes, of course. Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Nice lady.
Indeed.
Yeah.
I have since seen her live in Vegas.
Wow. Well, there you go.
She was doing a stint, like a mini season, I guess, at the at Caesar's Palace.
Yep.
In Vegas. Yeah.
And were you one of those guys that went up, you know, and said, "Hey, do you remember me, Sean?"
No, I'm not that kind of guy. No.
I know you're not. That's not your jam. Hey, what about Vanessa? Now, we'll talk about the Hey Hey It's first, but you and I have a special place in her musical journey, don't we? We actually helped Vanessa. Tell our viewers about that story.
Well, as brats, I think we were playing at what was that venue?
It was the Dandenong Club in Heatherton Road, eastern suburbs, Melbourne. Yes.
Again, back in the days where they had bands, you know.
Yeah.
And I think it was her either manager or promoter. I think it was Jack Strong.
That sounds right to me. Yeah. Yep.
Not sure of his last name. I may be wrong, but I know Jack had affiliations with Hey Hey It's Saturday.
Yep.
And I think he may have pretty much discovered Vanessa Amorosi as a new talent.
Yep.
And, of course, I think it was Andrew, our keyboard player at the time, that had a friendship, I think, maybe with Jack. And lo and behold, here's Vanessa Amorosi coming to join us on stage.
That's right, at the Dandenong Club of all places. And so just for clarification for our audience, she had not done a public performance. She hadn't had anything and Jack wanted to give her experience with a live band. And so he took us down to our band. And I think she might have been like 16 or something at the time and got up on stage and did a couple of Alanis Morissette tunes and absolutely blew away the audience, the pokey loving people from the Dandenong Club, who booed me when I got back on stage, mind you. I'll never forget that. It scarred me forever, Tony. but we were part of her journey. That was like one of her first sort of public performances.
It must have been her first ever public performance, I think.
Wow, there you go. And then I guess circling back, you know, you continue to be a part of her journey because you played that gig with her on Hey Hey It's Saturday, didn't you?
Which was her first television appearance, yeah.
Wow. So you've been her first in many ways, haven't you, Tony?
In more ways. Well, when you put it that way, Brian, in more ways than one, yes.
Yeah, well, and you've been so many people's first, so many along the journey, Tony, that in a musical sense, of course, I mean.
Of course.
Of course, of course. And do you remember much about that performance on Hey Hey? Was that a similar kind of vibe where you guys mimed and she sang the vocals live?
Yeah, exactly. It was a long time ago. I dig those early Melbourne years. They were fun. but, yeah, it was a track called Have a Look, which was her first single.
Yeah. Well, she was singing live then and was great, great vocals. But again, you got a lot of airtime, a lot of camera time because, you know, people, the camera follows the coolness, and they just found you there, didn't they?
Well, you want that phone to ring, Brian, you know, people
call
you back.
Hey, Tony, you may or may not know this, but we are sponsored. This little humble show of ours is sponsored by the amazing people at Cranbourne Music. And you know what? They are open They've got two stores in Lynbrook and Elizabeth Street City, and you can go in, buy your musical instruments. You can say, hey, Tony Richards inspired me to pick up a bass, and they will be able to look after you. You can click and collect. You can shop online. You can do anything. These guys will help you. Cranbourne Music, say Brian from Live from the Lockdown Lounge sent you, and they will look after you. There you go. That was a live read, Tony Richards.
Well done. And good on Cranbourne Music for jumping on board.
Yeah. Thank you, man. Hey, our new segment is Back When I Thought I Was Cool, and you've got a couple of entries in here. This segment is all about back in the day, how we looked at the time. And because it's such an important part of the musical journey, we had to create a sting for it. So roll the sting.
Ooh, how you like me now? How you like me now? Ooh.
Back when I thought I was cool.
There you go, Tony. That's me doing sexy voiceover voices there. Now, we've got two images. We've got one image of you back in sort of semi-Bratz days. This is yourself, myself, Steve, my brother, the man on the thumbs out there, who is keeping everybody interested with the Facebook feed, and then Andrew Patterson. So let's show this picture. And here we are, I believe, on Frankston foreshore, looking off into the distance. And you've got the John Lennon glasses on there and the long hair. How do you feel about that picture nowadays, Tony?
Well, you mentioned John Lennon. I think it's more of a Geddy Lee look.
Right.
You know, got that whole Rush thing going on. I didn't really know who Rush was back then, but looking back now, I think I look more like Geddy Lee.
Yeah. I've gone for more of the ghetto kind of look myself. Yeah. Actually, yeah. I'm not sure what I'm doing there, but yeah, the flat top and the Elvis Presley kind of vibe. And then you've got Steve, who's
That well. It was it was a good day at the pit.
And there's Steve just lying on the Frankston foreshore, which I wouldn't recommend to anybody to do. You know, it's not the place to go lying around. And now we've got a second shot of you back when you thought you were cool, and this was from your Killer Queen days with the old beret, the black and white look. I'm not sure that there's anything embarrassing about this image, Tony. You actually still look very, very cool.
Well, I did dig around, Brian, and that's about all I could come up with. it's not easy being this cool, Brian.
I can't imagine it is, and I can only imagine. There you go. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was Back When I Thought I Was Cool. We finish off this segment by rolling the sting. Roll the sting.
Ooh, how you like me now? How you like me now? Ooh.
Back when I thought I was cool.
There you go. Amazing, amazing. So, Tony, I guess we'll get into the heavy chat now and talk about your time in Vegas, which is obviously continuing, and how the whole COVID-19 thing has affected you. I thought a good way to start off this whole chat would be to run a video of, I believe it's the GM of the casino, who does a big sort of speech, a celebratory speech about 9 years that you guys have been at the Excalibur. So we're just going to run the video now.
9 years ago today, the Australian BG show opened at Excalibur Hotel. 9 years! Is that amazing or what? 9 years on the Las Vegas Strip. It's amazing. 9 years anywhere is a miracle. 9 years on the Vegas Strip is a holy miracle. As you know, you were trying to figure out what show to come see tonight. There are literally hundreds of shows on the Strip. And in the last 9 years, there have been hundreds of shows that have closed. To survive 9 years on the Strip is amazing. Not to mention, we had to import them all the way from Australia.
should go for 10.
So I would just like to say this. They have played over 60 countries across the world, over 6,000 performances. They have flown over 1 million miles. In over almost 25 years they've been together. And this July will be 25 years that they have been together. Amazing, right? There are three people on this stage that started this show 25 years ago, and they're still here, and they're still doing their utmost to give you the best show every night, and I'd like to show you who they are. The first one is our bass player, Tony Richards. Morris, or as we like to call him around the house, Wayne Hosking. And Barry, also known as Clifty or Michael Cliff.
So there he is talking and celebrating the fact that you guys have been there for 9 years. And he talks about the fact that so many bands have come and gone and what an amazing feat it is. It is pretty incredible that this humble Aussie band has been able to establish a foothold in Vegas for that period of time, isn't it?
Yes, you're quite right, Brian. I mean, we do have to slap ourselves some days and realize that it is quite a feat. It's a competitive place to be. I think back in 2016, there may have been 30 show closures in Vegas.
Wow.
That's a big deal when you consider the cost of setting up shows with getting in performers. They could be acrobats. They're all on visas. The production, huge costs, and when shows are around for 5 or 10 minutes and they disappear, there's a lot of money being lost. So we are very humbled that we still continue to last in Las Vegas, and I think the future will look good again once we bounce back from this.
Well, I mean, and we'll talk about COVID-19 in a minute, but the fact that you have lasted 9 years at the one casino, it's a tribute to obviously the music. You know, the Bee Gees music is timeless, but your professionalism and I guess being able to reinvent the show as well. So how many sort of incarnations have you had over that sort of 9 year period?
That's a good question too. I mean, the show is forever changing. We do have people that come back and see us time and time again. It's not unusual to hear that somebody has seen the show 30 times.
Wow. That's amazing.
And these aren't local. This is not a local, you know. So it's very important to keep reinventing the show, to keep changing it, not only for the audience, but, you know, for ourselves. We've changed the look of the showroom. We have a brand new showroom right now in Vegas.
Yep.
A lot of money's been spent on audio, video, production, so it's even more fun to present the show.
Of course, and it's the Excalibur Casino.
The Excalibur Hotel and Casino. Yeah.
Fantastic. And yeah. And it seats about 300 or so, 350.
Yeah,
is that right?
I think current seating, we could get near on 400.
Wow.
In the room.
Yep. And so just for, a lot of our viewers are musos that are currently working in the Melbourne circuit. And like I said a couple of times throughout the show, you're kind of at the mecca of cover bandom. You know, if you're going to be, you're going to pursue a career doing covers, you know, to get a residency in Vegas is kind of the top of the hill is the Everest. So how many, days a week are you playing? How many times a day are you playing?
Sure.
Give us a little idea of the schedule.
Sure. Well, the show is 6 nights per week, and we're dark on Fridays. That might seem odd that we don't perform Fridays.
Yeah, it is odd. Why is that? Is that a Vegas thing that's a little nuance of Vegas?
A lot of people are traveling on a Friday to come to Vegas for the weekend. A lot of people may drive from California. They might be, you know, shagged up, completely tired from traveling. So yeah, that could be a reason.
Yep. Yeah. Fair enough. And so is it two shows a day? Is that right?
No. It's just the one show. We did kick off back in 2011 as a 7 p.m. show. We're now down to a 5 p.m. show, would you believe?
Wow.
5 p.m., that's right. Yeah. And we're out of there. We're done by 6:20.
Wow. And so
I'd be all tucked up in bed by 9, Brian, if I wanted to be, you know.
How often do you want to be, though? That's the real question.
Well, it is Vegas, so, you know, it is a little tempting to kick on a little bit, you know.
Yes. And so 6 nights a week, you're on at 5, you're out of there by 6:20.
6:20, 6:30, you know, give or take, yeah.
Yep. I guess you have been doing it for so long that it's pretty streamlined. So how much, you know, is there sound checks anymore, or is it sort of...
There is.
Yep. So tell me about that process, because a lot of our musos would love to hear that.
If it's a 5 p.m. show, we'll generally lob up at say, 4 p.m.
Yep.
And it's more of a line check. Yep. Come rehearsal, if we have new subs coming in that we're taking on, we use that time to run over anything that they wish.
Yep. Okay. And speaking of subs, so you've got the crew that does the Vegas shows, but then you have requests to perform all around the world as well. And so you've got maybe 3, perhaps even 4 different incarnations of the Australian Bee Gees show that you can send all around the world.
Correct. And one of my roles is I'm lumped with resourcing.
Really?
So you're right. We have the fixed Vegas show, and then 2 touring shows.
Fantastic. And as a founding member, so the show's been going for 25 years. Is that right?
24 years. Yeah.
Yeah. It's coming into the 25th. Year anniversary. Correct. Which is about the same time as my 25th wedding anniversary. We should do a group celebration in Vegas.
Hey, do not threaten me with a good time, Brian.
Well, we could be there. We could be there, provided we're allowed to travel. We could come and celebrate 25 years of marriage and, yeah, staying alive. So, let's go into that a little bit more. So you've got the two touring bands, and you've got the show band in Vegas. As a founding member, do you get to pick and choose the gigs that you want to go on?
Well, we work very closely with SPI Entertainment in Las Vegas. And Steck and his staff are good friends of ours.
Yep.
So we will have agents that will find and source gigs throughout, certainly America, Canada.
Yep.
Our plate is normally full with touring shows. And we still come here to Australia twice a year.
Right. Yep.
With Harbour Agency.
Okay.
We work closely with Harbour Agency, yeah.
Fantastic. So how many performers would you say are on your books in terms of the different, ABG's show?
We've got around 20.
Wow.
No, certainly no less than 20.
Yep.
To resource the 3 shows.
Yep. Fantastic. Yeah. And do you, having played in Vegas for 9 years straight, do you have a preference for whether you, like, do you say, okay, maybe after 6 months I'm going to do a tour, or I'm going to go off on back to Australia? Do you have a bit of a schedule, or do you just sort of take it as it comes?
Yeah, look, if Cancun comes up, I'm on it, you know. No, seriously, yeah, it's good to just to mix it up a little bit. Doing 6 nights in Vegas, there are some great shows and venues that do come up. And if you feel like getting out of town, well, we'll discuss that. there's generally, you know, four of us that take care of the, you know, day-to-day runnings of the whole operation. So we're always in discussion and, you know, we'll pick and choose and mix and match and...
Yep, yep.
Generally make sure everyone's happy, you know?
Well, look, you know, like I said, a lot of our viewers are musos, and what would you say, because you've reached the pinnacle, you've been, you know, you're so successful. What do you think has sort of been the main ingredient that's made you sort of ascend through the Melbourne, Australia gigs, international gigs, and then to finally get you into Vegas? What's that one little thing that you reckon that has been the thing that's got you over the line?
Well, just that. You know, we often discussed, you know, way back in the piece, where do we want to take this thing? There's not too many places in the world where you can go and perform six nights per week. You've got Vegas, you know, you could do Chicago for a run, New York, you know, Broadway, or maybe London's West End. Where else can you actually do six nights a week without overselling yourself? So, it was that we knew back then that Vegas would be the pinnacle, and that's something that's always been a driving force for us.
Yep. Well, that's really interesting. So you had a roadmap, you set your destination, and then I guess once you know where you want to go, then you can go about formulating the intricacies of the plan. What do you need to be as an entertainment entity to get there? And I guess you compare yourself to the others that are working there, and that's the level of professionalism and artistry that you need to ascertain to be able to compete or even get a look in.
Quite right. I mean, the material is there. There's at least five decades worth of hits with the Bee Gees.
Good point.
Probably a number one single. You know, number ones were prevalent. So it the material is there. I mean, the challenge for us was to, I guess, reproduce that faithfully, authentically.
Yep. Yeah. Well, look, we'll come back.
This is an easy sell.
Sorry, say that again.
Again, with the material and with the presentation of the show, it can be an easy sell because most people coming to Vegas know exactly what they're in for when they see the billboards and the advertising.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know what? I reckon this is a good time to actually show a little clip of what you would consider, and I've read interviews that you've done, as one of the best gigs that you've ever performed, and this was with the Boston Pops. So give us a little bit of an intro about this experience and, you know, why you rate it as one of the best gigs that you've ever done.
Well, we were honoured that we were approached by the Boston Pops to come to Boston. They actually came, a representative did come to Vegas and saw our show and saw potential to have five of us travel to Boston, rehearse with their 85-piece orchestra at the Boston Symphony Hall, Boston Concert Hall.
Yep.
Great experience. And then float everything over to a place called Nantucket Island, where there's, I think, 11,000 people on the beach.
Right.
And that was the gig. I mean, it was just to hear the everything come alive with the orchestration. Wayne Hosking, my dear colleague, charted everything for this 85-piece orchestra.
Wait.
One hell of an undertaking.
He charted for an 85-piece orchestra. Holy crap. How long did that take him?
Well, he's
still going.
He's still
5
going.
Years after the event, he's still going.
Yeah, five guys didn't turn up because they didn't have their chance.
Wow.
No, he did a sterling job. One quick rehearsal, pretty terrifying, I might add.
Yep.
We managed to pull this whole thing together, and you'll see in the video then.
All right, so let's throw it to the video. So this is basically a bit of a mashup of the whole performance, and you go through all the songs and see the crowd, and you know, it's it's pretty phenomenal. So Tony Richards, the Australian Bee Gees show with the Boston Pops. Let's check out the video.
Ladies and gentlemen, get your dancing shoes on and be prepared to give a warm Nantucket welcome to the Australian Bee Gees show.
There you are, Tony. That is just amazing. I know our audience would be looking at you and go, wow. So what's it like from a musical point of view playing with a 80, 90-piece orchestra? What was that sensation like?
Well, again, you know, each night when we perform, we have our tracks, which we're not heavily tracked. You know, we've got mainly brass and strings.
Yep.
But to hear everything come alive with actual real-time instruments, it's lush. It's completely, yep. You know.
Yep.
Again, just one of those surreal experiences. I mean, the Boston Pops would have to be, I think, arguably one of the best orchestras in the world. So to be in their company, Brian,
yep,
pretty damn good.
Yes, as it would be in my company, I would imagine.
Well, that's a given.
That's a small monkey is a given. I digress. Hey, we actually haven't spoken about the whole COVID-19 thing. So, look, we'll touch on that briefly, because basically the whole Vegas was or is shut down at the moment, and for you, that is coordinating the logistics of the band for postponements and things like that. It's a massive undertaking. So give us a little insight into, you know, what the deal is in Vegas at the moment from a generic point of view, and what the plan is moving forward, and then what your experience is now postponed gigs.
Correct. Well, I mean, firstly, a friend of mine sent me a video the other day. He was driving up the strip, and to not see anybody, not one person walking on the strip was quite eerie. You know, it's surreal. It's just not something that we're used to seeing, and hopefully we'll never see that again. But yes, it certainly has called for the shutdown of our show, which I think happened on May the 15th.
Yep.
Which was pretty shocking. Again, I was not there for that. I was here actually at that point, but I got news that the show's closed.
Wow.
For a possible reopening on May 1st.
Yes.
But, that's just all way too early.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to take more time. Our governor, a man called Steve Sisolak, has issued a reopening plan that will be in phases, but the restrictions on group gatherings, which can be no more than 10 people at this point, if they kick on, it'll be a little while before we can reopen the show, I think.
Yeah, and there's no real timeline to that. I mean, it's such a moving beast. Obviously, in the US, they're suffering greatly, and different parts of the country are suffering more, obviously. You see what's going on in New York. But so it's but each governor has jurisdiction over that part of the country in terms of how and when they open it up. So as far as you know, there's no real timeline as to when you may kind of be back.
Well, look, we do have a gig booked in Nevada on June the 3rd.
Yeah.
And to my knowledge, that has not been cancelled or postponed yet. So I'm working, that's a rough target for me to shoot at this point. But again, if these group gathering restrictions are still applicable, well, that I can't see that going ahead, but we have to plan for it.
Yeah. And from I guess a mental health, we always talk about mental health on this show, and for how musicians are coping, because obviously when you take away their source of income but also their source of passion and their ability to express their art, it does have an impact. How are you going from that point of view, and your colleagues and your network from a mental health point of view?
Well, again, it's a matter of trying to remain positive in these pretty tough times. A lot of musicians in Vegas do live sort of hand to mouth.
Yep.
There are some great players that are just, you know, working from paycheck to paycheck, and you know, the bills don't stop coming in.
Of course, no.
Again, I think other friends of mine, other musician friends of mine, are using the time to write or record, learn a new skill. So that, you know, there can be some positive things to come out of a lockdown, maybe some new discoveries.
Yep.
But still, it's tough. I mean, a lot of my friends who play in the big Cirque shows, it's here one day, and then it's all of a sudden gone. So it's very, very hard to plan for that. If you have nothing, no cash reserves, you'll be feeling the pinch, no question about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And we always sort of recommend that to any of our listeners or any musician brethren out there, entertainers, if you're struggling, you know, seek professional help, jump on Beyond Blue, you know, speak, talk to other people. There's plenty of people that are willing to hear your story, to support you. And we have our lockdownlounge.live website, where all of these websites are available. We often ask our artists if they would like any contributions made to any particular charities. You've mentioned a couple, Tony, that you would like any donations made to. Tell us about them.
Yes. Well, you know, firstly, for the arts, there's lots of great actors and comedians and musicians who have had their whole calendar wiped out.
Yep.
Again, impossible to plan for. So, you know, I think the support act certainly come to mind.
Yep.
And right. I think that would be a really good way of you know, helping out people, our colleagues, our friends in the arts.
Yep. No, that's a great one. And I know a lot of our artists that have been on the show have mentioned Support Act. So please jump on Support Act. The website will be coming up on your screen right now, and support them and help them. All those entertainers out there that are struggling now. We talked about, you know, some of your colleagues and friends and things like that from Vegas. I think it would be remiss of us not to do a little bit of name dropping here and show some images of some of the people that you've met. And these, I guess, for the bass players out there. So the first image we've got is of Rocco Prestia from Tower of Power. So that image is up on your screen now. Tell us about that little meeting there, Tony.
Well, I was. We have a very good Monday night gig in Vegas. It cost $10 to get in, but it's the cream of Vegas players that get right. In a band called Santa Fe and the Fat City Horns. So it's a big, probably at least a 15-piece band.
Yep.
Phenomenal knockout players, world class.
Yep.
And you'll get guys like Rocco was just happened to be in the. In the audience that night.
Wow.
So for me to meet Rocco Prestia, king of the 16th notes, even guys like Jaco Pastorius were influenced by Rocco Prestia. Lived hard, still plays a bit. He's had some health problems, Rocco has, but still hangs in there. But for me to meet that guy, I'd never thought in my wildest dreams as a young bass player in Auckland, you know, New Zealand or Australia, that you would ever meet somebody like that.
Yeah, yeah. No, well, that's I guess that's Vegas for you, isn't it? And then here we've got another image of you with Stanley Clark. So tell us about that one.
Well, same thing applies, Brian. You know, that's a very famous right hand on my right shoulder.
Yeah.
This is Stanley Clark's famous big right hand on my right shoulder. I'm thinking,
fantastic.
So that guy is a jazz monster. And, you know, to meet again and to have a discussion, I bought an Alembic bass.
Yep.
Because of Stanley Clark. Stanley right. Clark made the Alembic quite famous. So on that, I went out and bought an Olympic bass.
Wow. Meeting your heroes, that's it's got to be good. And this gentleman who we had another great bass player from Melbourne, Dan Linders, talk about this gentleman, Victor Wooten, who came to Melbourne and actually saw Dan Linders play, and here you are with him in Vegas. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah. Again, that was the same Monday night.
Wow.
A different Monday night, but the same event, if you like, and to meet Victor Wooten. That guy's a, you know, a complete monster on the bass.
Yeah.
And just to talk to him about life and about upcoming projects that he's got, that kind of thing, you certainly go home on a high.
Fantastic. Well, yeah, look, it's I imagine that and we'll go into this with Geek Chicken in terms of the famous people that you meet, but you know, Vegas would just be such a hot spot for celebrities and movie stars and, you know, musical icons. You must just rub shoulders with the best of them.
What we do, yeah. I mean, there's no shortage of talent.
well,
you know, yeah.
Well, which brings us to our next segment, Tony. So we call this segment Gig Chicken, and any muso. I imagine even in Vegas they serve the musos chicken, and so we've got this this segment. So it's boiled chicken, it's fried chicken, it's diced chicken. Any other chickens that you can think of that you've had over the years?
No, I think you've got a... You've pretty much got...
There you go. You let me drive this baby, Tony. I'll drive this baby home. Don't you worry about that. You just sit back and relax. So, again, an important segment that we need to have a sting for, and it's chicken... it's teeing on the Buck Box and the Chicken Harmonies. Roll the sting! There you go. That was Gig Chicken, and we always finish off with a little harmony. I won't get you to harmonize, Tony, but it's a Gig Chicken. There you go. Now, nice. I'm going to ask you a series of questions, Tony. If you get them correct, you will receive chicken in the mail. It will arrive between 4 and 78 working days, couriered to you, and it will still be reasonably warm. So your time starts now. Some of these questions we may have already crossed over, but that's okay. Question number one, the best gig you have ever played.
For me, look, it does come back to the Boston Pops. Yep. Just the sheer magnitude of that.
Yep.
That kind of wins.
It does. Down. Yeah, yeah. Just 88-piece orchestra?
85-piece orchestra.
Yeah, yeah. There was three extras. There was three roadies there as well that I counted when I was looking. So it's 88 in my by my count. But, yeah, 85-piece orchestra. It was an outdoor gig as well.
On the beach, 11,000 people. We finished the gig and the rain and the clouds opened up. So we need to get the gig done.
Yep. You think of everything. Your production values are just so spot on. You got to link in with the weatherman and what's that that nursery rhyme? There once was a man from Nantucket and.
You know the rest. You know how that goes.
Yes. All right. Question number two. Weirdest gig you ever played?
Well, yeah, that's a good one. I mean, doing years of corporate gigs, you know, especially in Asia,
yeah,
they can be very stark. They can be very, very cold and not the most responsive type gig from an audience perspective until the CEO gets up of a corporate. Once the CEO is up, then everyone's into it.
Right.
So, Malaysia, Singapore, that's generally the norm. People will not get up and enjoy themselves until the head honcho is up there shaking his thing, you know.
Right. Okay. And so you really need to target the CEO whenever you're performing, get him or her on the dance floor, and then it cascades.
The rest of the music.
Yeah. Okay. So that's good. Cool. All right. Question. Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Question three. Last time you were nervous?
Yeah, good question. To this day, If I get friends or family coming to a gig, I still get the butterflies. It's weird.
Awesome.
Mainly friends or family. I'm still to get a little introspective there and try and work that stuff out. But it's mainly.
Yeah.
I get a few friends or family come to the gig, or sometimes your peers that you respect as musicians. Yeah, you get a little. Little jerky, you know?
Yeah, a little jerky. Jerky boys. Let's not go down that track. that's really interesting. We haven't had that one before, but no, I get it. Definitely other musos, but also family members that know you and know your little nuances and know that if it's not quite right, so they know. Yep. With you all the way. Okay, now this is this question I've almost had to adjust because every player that I've asked in Australia, Melbourne, has said the same song. It won't be the same for you, however, but the most requested song.
From the Bee Gees catalogue, do you mean?
Look, it can be from the Bee Gees catalogue. It's just, yeah, like the song that's all, I guess that's your current project. So, yeah, let's go with that. Let's go with that, yep.
Well, again, it depends. It depends where the show is playing. I mean, what was popular with the Bee Gees in Australia can differ to say America. There's a, I think it was the Bee Gees' first single called Spicks and Specks, which went number one in Australia.
Yep.
We've tried playing it in America and we, you know, they don't want to know about it. So we adjust the set list and work out what was popular in, you know, forever, you know, wherever we're going. We'll try and do some, research into that, you know.
Yeah. Well, that's...
But again, to get back to your question, how deep is your love is a big one.
Okay.
To love somebody is another big one.
Yep.
You win again gets, you know, people want to hear that too. So, you know, these are, and they span decades.
Yeah. And it's funny because I would have thought it would be something like Staying Alive or something like that, but it's not. I guess the really hard, rusted on Bee Gees fan are more into their really sort of ballady type stuff.
Well, certainly Staying Alive is up there as well. It's yep. probably one of the even, you know, it's, you could arguably say that it's one of the better known Bee Gees songs. I mean, You Should Be Dancing is great.
Yep.
And such phenomenal bass lines. So as a bass player, very, very fun to play.
Yeah. Well, I remember when we were when you first started the project. I think I was exposed to Bee Gees music, but hadn't really listened to it intricately. And I remember you saying at the time that it's great bass lines, and which made me, it piqued up my interest to really listen to it again.
Oh yeah, sure.
Okay, you're going very well. So there's definitely a chance that you will be receiving some gig chicken soon, Mr. Tony Richards.
Rubber chicken is fine, Brian. Rubber chicken
first. Okay. Whatever you do with the chicken is your own business. I just want to say.
Go on.
Okay. Question five. Now, most famous person that you've met or performed for. Okay. So we're talking, you know, top of the pops here. We're talking because you've had a few famous that have come through and seen the show. I guess you've rubbed shoulders with a few. So most famous person in your eyes?
Well, again, having met the bass players that I talked about earlier, yep. Having played Shania is probably the most famous person I've performed with.
Yep.
And yeah, we do get, you know, we in Vegas, you know, there's lots of actors, performers from other shows that come and see us.
Yep.
Britney Spears.
Right. Was this the bald head Britney or the with hair Britney?
Well, I should clarify that she only came to use our bathroom in the green room.
All right. For
she was there to see the show after ours, which is Thunder from Down Under.
So you don't do any stripping in your show?
No, I'm trying to cut down, Brian.
And so was Brittany using the toilet, or was she just using the bathroom for a secluded area to
use the toilet? But because, you know, she was all high security bodyguards and stuff, she was ushered off and instructed to use our facilities because, you know, it's...
Yeah. Well, that's pretty damn good. Britney Spears is pretty damn good, Tony. Good entry. Didn't you? I'm sure you told me at some point that you met some of the Jackson 5 at some point.
Yeah, true. Jackson 5 for sure. They were also doing a show on the Strip,
right?
For a limited season, again through SPI Entertainment. Jackson 5. Actually, Meatloaf was doing we did something with Meatloaf as well. Meatloaf. But again, these are guys that, you know, blow through town all of the time, and there's no telling who you'll run into. I mean, there's probably a few names I could rattle off, but it does get a bit of a blur sometimes.
Yeah, well, you know, they're probably on shows, the Lockdown Lounge in the US, talking about the fact that they met Tony Richards. That's probably what they're doing right now.
I'd be chuffed.
Well, hey, Britney Spears and Jackson 5 is not a bad entry into Gig Chicken, I must say. So I'm honoured to say that you have won Gig Chicken, Tony. Chicken will be coming to you in the mail within 4 to 78 days, working days. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Gig Chicken. Run the sting. Yes, Kick Chicken. Tony Richards, you have been a delight to talk to. Thank you for sharing your time with us and your talent and your magic with us. It's been an absolute joy. Please make sure that you before you go back to Vegas, that you come back to my place for some curried chicken, not gig chicken, curried chicken that I will.
That is my proposal to you. I'll waive my fee for today if you cook me a chicken curry.
Done. Deal. Absolutely. Now, coming up this week on our Thursday night show, just to let our audience know, this is our night of nights, our biggest show. It's live from the live from the lockdown lounge, the concert edition. So it's just the music, just all the musical performances from all the acts that we have had so far in just one big show. I'm even going to wear my tuxedo and my bow tie. I'll bring a piece of red carpet that I will put on the desk as well. It's going to be amazing. So all of our artists and their music performance, one long show. So probably a lot less of me, which is a little bit of a dampener, I'd imagine, for me and my family. But for the rest of you, it'll be good. So don't forget, Thursday night, live from the Lockdown Lounge, the concert edition. Now, Tony, we always finish off. Don't go away, because we want to. We want you to have a closing segment, a closing message of hope for our guests. We always finish off the show with how people are coping with lockdown all over the world. And one way to cope with lockdown is to play tricks on your grandmother. By giving her some stinky hand sanitizer and seeing her reaction. So we're going to roll a video of somebody giving his grandma stinky sanitizer, hand sanitizer. Now, we must warn you that that there is some language, some fruity language in this video clip. I don't know. I don't think our audience will care too much, but hey, I've put out the warning there. So this is how some people are coping with lockdown. Roll the video.
Hey, what's up, you guys? I just ordered some stanky ass hand sanitizer. Looks completely normal, but smells like stanky ass. And I'm going to see if I can get Granny to use this. Granny, you ready?
Yeah, I've been fucking ready.
Well, let's go.
Shit.
I've been ready for the past 20 minutes.
Bullshit.
Come on, slowpoke.
Fuck you. What the hell's taking them so long?
I don't know.
I thought they was ready to fucking go.
Here, you want some hand sanitizer?
Yeah, give me a little. What the fuck?
What's wrong?
What the fuck's that smell?
I don't smell anything.
Hey, something in here smells like fucking shit. Oh, hell. Can't you smell it?
No.
Oh, fuck no. That damn hand sanitizer or something smells just like fucking shit.
Let me take a smell. Oh!
Oh, motherfucker!
Did you wipe your butt with your hand?
I'll be back in a fucking minute. I'm gonna wash this damn fucking shit out. I don't know what's making it smell like that. God bless.
Did you wash them?
Yes.
Did you get the smell off of them?
Fuck no, it still smells like fucking shit.
Let me smell. Ugh, did you use soap?
Yeah.
It don't smell like it.
Well, I did. And I ain't going no place with my hands smelling like shit. Fuck, motherfucker. I'm going in the fucking house. Hell with this. Fuck you. I'm going in the house and I'm going to wash them again. I'll get me some damn bleach and see if that'll help them.
We're leaving.
I'm not going with my hands smelling like shit.
Come on.
Hell no.
Get in the car.
There you go, Tony. That was what you do. I respect my grandma far too greatly to give her stanky hand sanitizer, but, you know, what do you say? Now, Tony Richards, thank you again. You've been a joy to interview. Thank you for imparting your knowledge onto us. I know a lot of the musos that watch this show that are in the Melbourne circuit will really appreciate a lot of the words of wisdom that you've given us, because, like I said, you're at the pinnacle, you're at the, you know, the Everest of cover bandom. Any last messages for our audience, whether it's a message of hope or, you know, just how they should go about their process of sort of making it to the top? What would you like to say?
Well, Brian, I think whether you're living and performing here in Melbourne or with, like me, if you're in Las Vegas, we will come back. We'll bounce back. Vegas has been terrific in terms of raising money. We've had some great fundraisers for the arts. That's just happened in the last week or so. Vegas always comes back. We came back after the after that horrible shooting that we had at Mandalay Bay. Vegas is a strong community. It's like a little country town, actually. When things go wrong, people do band together, and it's a great place to be. But parting messages. What do? We have to be kind. We have to help each other. We have to think about people who are working out there and putting their own lives on the line for us right now. Doctors, nurses, people delivering food, support staff. I mean, hats off to those guys, really. Be good, be kind, stay safe.
Great message, and it's simple message, but yeah, you know, because everybody's on edge a little bit, and just that it's such a simple thing to be kind to people, and we kind of forget that. And I think it's front of mind. Wow. You just put out that energy and it does come back to you, people. Put out the positivity and it comes back to you. It's a simple logarithm equation even. So Tony, thank you again. You've been a wonderful guest. You know what? We have been brought to you by Cranbourne Music, ladies and gentlemen. Cranbourne Music, and their stores are open in Lynbrook and Elizabeth Street City. Get online, click and collect, or get it delivered, or just go into the store because they're open. Thank you once again, Tony. We'll see you very soon for a chicken curry. You have been watching live from the Lockdown Lounge. Don't forget, on Thursday night, we have our concert show. All the artists that have been on, musical performance. It's all about the music. I am Brian, your host. I know this because it says so just down there. You've been watching live from the Lockdown Lounge. Good night.